Test, test, test.
Yes, we are here.
Oh my God, that's not CJ Hurt.
It's me. It is I.
It is me, Bennett.
I'm struggling today.
Welcome to mornings, Bennett Doyle.
There's no coffee in the break room.
God.
Like, that is like the worst way to start this. I'm going to try.
You're going to try without coffee, or you're going to try the coffee machine again?
I'm going to try to do this without the coffee, but I don't know. I don't know.
If anyone's out there, please bring Bennett a Starbucks ASAP.
Or just like a,
one of the coffees
from the break room somewhere. That's all I need.
What time did you wake up this morning?
Like 6.
Ooh.
Yeah. When did you wake up?
4:30.
That's insane.
I woke up before my alarm today.
I don't know how you do this.
Oh my God. I'm doing well this morning.
Yeah, you look it.
I'm awake. I'm rested. The Grizzlies won a game.
Yes, they did.
It's amazing what happens
when
the Grizzlies win. Even a meaningless game. I forgot. You're supposed to ask me the question, what was the song of the day?
What was the song of the day?
It was Billy Joel's Longest Time. And I haven't listened to that song in a really long time. For the longest time.
It's a good song.
Some nice little harmonies in
there. Yeah, it's like, a nice song.
Do you like Billy Joel?
Okay, I didn't want you to ask me that. He's fine.
I've had a weird evolution with Billy Joel, so I'm with you. I loved Billy Joel.
Now that you're an adult, you love some Billy Joel?
No. I loved him when I was a kid.
Okay.
I went to a Billy Joel, Elton John, dueling pianos concert.
Yeah, I remember that. That was a big tour.
I was like the coolest 14-year-old in the world.
Yeah.
But I've kind of grown out of him. Like, he popped up at the Grammys this year.
Yeah.
I was like, meh.
Oh, the new song was eh.
Oh, yeah, the new song was eh.
No, I respect, though. Respect. He's a legend.
Yeah. All the respect.
Yeah.
I don't listen to Billy the way I used to. So, when one came up, it was a good day. It is April 4th, a Thursday. It is going to be a good day. Jessica Benson with you from the Grind City Media Studios in Memphis, Tennessee. Bennett Doyle in for CJ Hurt behind the glass. Coming up on today's show, yes, the Memphis Grizzlies got a win last night in Milwaukee. Jaren Jackson Jr. was a force, a monster yet again. Brandon Clarke looks to be back. We'll talk about it all. It is Marc Gasol jersey retirement week, and as we celebrate all week long here on Grind City Media, I know a lot of you have loved the documentary Memphis Made, Marc Gasol. Well, its director, Michael Blevins, is going to be in studio to share some stories from how it was made, some of his favorite interviews, hardest interviews, everything you could possibly want to know about the Marc Gasol documentary. Then we'll do some miscellaneous sports stories. There's been a proposed Super League in college football. UConn had major flight issues trying to get to the Final Four. UConn, they're just like the rest of us. And then in honor of Bennett Doyle, my fellow movie buff, being here today for our draft day on a Thursday, we are going to draft the 2024 movies that we are most excited for. So the only criteria is it has to come out between today, April 4th, and the rest of 2024. We will talk about the best to come in movies throughout the summer, the fall, all that and more. It's a Thursday. It's almost Friday. Let's go.
Maxwell in concert. The Serenade Tour. October 16th at FedEx Forum. Maxwell. With special guest Jasmine Sullivan. And October London. Tickets on sale now at livenation.com. Don't miss Maxwell Live.
Real country music with Cody Johnson live Saturday, April 13th at FedEx Forum. Country's best. The Leather Tour with Cody Johnson with special guest Justin Moore, also featuring Drake Milligan. VIP and reserve seats on sale at Ticketmaster.com in the FedEx Forum box office. Cody Johnson.
Did I invent this? Low-key?
Did you?
I spent years calling my ex-producer Cowboy Carson, and now Beyonce?
She decides
she wants to dabble in country, in the genre. Now she's calling her album Cowboy Carter.
When she's doing her next concert, and she says, hey, my new album's about to come out, Cowboy Carter.
Inspired by the Gary Parrish Show.
Shout out GP in Memphis.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Gasol with 4 seconds for the win. Yes! Marc is one of the more competitive people you'll meet.
Yeah, he moves.
That willingness to go out and try to compete every day, not just wait for a game, not wait for a regular season game, not wait for a playoff game, but every day is what made Marc special.
He was a big part of that identity, right? And a big part of that's why the team was so successful, because they had that anchor in him.
The Grizzlies, to this day, wouldn't be the Grizzlies without the contribution of Marc Gasol.
Don't worry, be fluffy world tour.
The minute you get into a brand new relationship, like magic, you know who really notices just how happy you are, guys? Other women, not your woman. Look how happy he is. I bet I can change that.
Friday, May 10th, FedEx Forum. Get your tickets now at fluffyguy.com. Don't miss a Memphis. Don't worry, be fluffy world tour.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, after exciting hoops and a lucky night of gaming, where do you rest your head? Look no further than Southland Casino Hotel, proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies. Our high-rise hotel is the epitome of luxury and comfort. Picture this, you've just finished an evening of gaming and dining, so you head on over to one of our 300 rooms to end the night. Choose from standard suite and presidential suite, plus we're pet-friendly and offer mobility scooters for rent. It's a seamless experience for everyone. And don't miss the Main Street Exchange, right in the heart of our casino lobby. Whether you're craving a snack or need a souvenir of your stay, we've got you covered. From polo shirts to shot glasses, take a piece of the Southland excitement home with you. So come stay and play at Southland Casino Hotel, where every moment is designed for your enjoyment. Book your hotel stay by calling 833-703-3350 or visit online at southlandcasinohotel.com/hotel.
Guests must be 21 years of age or older to check in at hotel. Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Presents The Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hertz, live from the Grind City Media Studios on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
What's up, everybody? Happy Thursday, almost Friday, to you all. Bennett Doyle in for CJ Hertz. Bennett Doyle without a cup of coffee, but you might get one, Bennett.
That's what I'm hearing. If somebody brings me a cup of coffee, then they are a legend forever in my book.
They would also be a legend in my book. Very rare do we get a very fun Grizzlies win to talk about. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining us for this special, special occasion. Before we get into all the happenings of Grizzlies Bucks last night, I did have a question for you.
Yeah, what's up?
Do you ever accidentally make yourself cry before 8 a.m.?
I mean, I thought about crying today. Again, I couldn't get a coffee. I lost my AirPods, so I'm struggling this morning. I almost cried, but no, I didn't.
Okay.
I didn't. I held it in. Why?
Okay. Well, I didn't cry because thinking about, you know, the future of the Grizzlies in a positive way. Like, those would be tears of joy, Jaren Jackson Jr. and Gigi Jackson and Jordan Goodwin beat the Milwaukee Bucks on a casual Wednesday night, although that is fun and fantastical. I was prepping for the show this morning, and as mentioned, we're doing a movies draft of the best of 2024 movies that are still to come. And so I happened to be on YouTube doing a little research, and the algorithm spit me out into I love hate when this happens. Mm-hmm. Random video that I didn't anticipate to watch this morning. It was the 2015 Kennedy Center honors.
Okay. And deep cut.
Yes, very right. Deep cut. And it was the Carole King honoree performance and celebration. And okay. So I kind of just had it on in the background because I love Carole King songs. I was like, oh, this will be nice to, you know, read through Grizzly stuff and this College Football Super League and whatever. And so they're doing performances, and Janelle Monáe pops up and she's lovely, and James Taylor pops up and he's lovely, Sarah Bareilles, and I'm like, yeah, we're jamming. And then I completely forgot what happened at the 2015 Kennedy Center Awards.
Aretha Franklin
comes out in a big fur coat.
Okay, I remember
and
this.
And she starts doing Natural Woman at the piano, playing and singing. Barack Obama himself is crying. And then he's wiping away a tear. And then next thing I knew, I was wiping away a tear. So I've already cried today. It's been a full day. That was my good point. And if you need something to bring you joy on this little Thursday, the whole thing is like 25 minutes. Not everyone has a full 25 to give, but just go watch the Aretha. She ended up dying 2 years later. So it's one of her last performances that we ever got. She was a force. A force.
Legend.
At that part. In her age still. Anyway, Aretha Franklin, legend, 2024 Memphis Grizzlies, not exactly legendary, although it may be what they've been able to do to the Milwaukee Bucks will be legendary. We had the game before the All-Star break where they beat the Milwaukee Bucks on TNT, and it's so funny because I went to watch last night's game, or I was going to work out before last night's game, and I was trying to squeeze it in before tip, and I flipped on my TV, and it was on ESPN, and my TV guide said Grizzlies Bucks 6:30 ESPN. I'm like, no, that cannot be right. I was just looking at my calendar and it's a 7 o'clock tip and it's not on ESPN. How did I miss that the Grizzlies had a nationally televised game? It's one of the flexed games.
That's
obviously
right.
So no.
Yeah, they pushed us out.
Weirdly, they switched us with a Celtics Thunder. Cannot understand why they wouldn't want to grace the world with Grizzlies Bucks, but I'm convinced it's because they want it to be a secret. They want all of our excitement for next season. The fear that will be placed amongst the NBA when they realize what the Grizzlies could potentially be next year, if and when, I won't say if, I'll say when they are fully healthy, is a remarkable thing to find yourself pondering on a casual April 4th or April 3rd when it's been such a disappointing season. But the Grizzlies do beat the Bucks last night, 111-101. We got the call 13 moment. You saw Jaren Jackson Jr. dial it up, take the jaw.
Doing his best Steph Curry impression.
The step back.
Yeah, that was impressive. I didn't know that was in his bag necessarily.
That's the thing about Jaren Jackson Jr.'s bag. And I think sometimes we, and I certainly would say that collective NBA fans, I wouldn't say take it for granted, but just don't understand how deep it is. Because within the same game, you saw the complexities of what makes Jaren Jackson Jr. one of the most tantalizing bigs in the NBA. You saw him in the first half of that game. I mean, he was at will scoring on Brooke Lopez and on Giannis Antetokounmpo. And you know what he gives to you defensively. But to see Jaren last night have 35 points on 26 shots in a game where Giannis is held to, 10 of 23? Mm-hmm. It was a tough shooting night for Giannis. And so Jaren very much looked like the best player on the court. And before we keep going, I know the Milwaukee Bucks were without Damian Lillard and were out without Chris Middleton. But, have you not been paying attention to who the Grizzlies are without? I think it's a wash.
Yeah, I think so, too.
I think you can very much call it a wash. And the Bucks are on the second night of a back-to-back. But they've now lost to the Wizards without Kyle Kuzma.
Dude.
And they've lost to the Memphis Grizzlies last night.
Yeah, they're 15-15 with Doc Rivers as the head coach.
Yeah.
I mean, that's obviously he's coming in the middle of the season, so I think it's, you can give the guy a little bit of pass there, but
can you? The whole reason, the postseason will speak everything, but I don't exactly get.
Should I stand up, by the way?
I don't know.
I feel like I look weird on the camera not standing.
Well,
what do you think, Jacob?
Oh,
okay, I'll stay down.
I thought
I looked weird. CJ stands.
Yeah, it helps with the whole energy thing. CJ doesn't drink coffee. And
this morning, neither
do you. So maybe you need to stand out.
CJ doesn't need coffee.
He does not.
No.
He does not. But it was one of those games where, for Jaren, and I'll bring this up because I talked about it very early this week. I don't think I mentioned it necessarily on the show, but coming out of that game against the Orlando Magic on Saturday, that abysmal performance by the Grizzlies, a game that many people didn't watch. The NCAA tournament's going on. There are better things on your television to watch. But he had 4 points in that game. And I kind of came out of it like, okay, if that's where we're at in this season with Jaren, shut him down. Get him to the 65 games.
Yep.
Have this be
the end.
We're
there, right? Yeah.
He played his 66th last night, which I did think was impressive that he played last night. He didn't have to.
Right.
He's eligible for postseason if he is able to make that second all-defense team. But instead of just completely imploding the rest of the way, the Grizzlies have won 2 games in a row, which we haven't talked about a whole lot this season. And it's been because of Jaren Jackson Jr., who had 40 against the Pistons and then follows it up with 35 last night. And I do not know if this is to be the case, but I'm going to create the situation in my head where Jaren Jackson Jr. got inspo from watching the Marc Gasol documentary. Because I sure did. Watching that Gasol documentary and how much winning meant to Marc Gasol, even when you were with a team. That's why that 19-game losing streak crushed the soul of Marc Gasol, because he's not built for that. And I would like to believe that Jaren Jackson Jr. maybe sat down, pressed play, and was like, oh, shit. Like, I am the leader of this team right now. I'm at the very least going to go and give my all in any time I have the opportunity to get on the court and create some momentum going into next season. And I'll take these two wins, bottle them up, and call it good.
I think there actually might be something. I actually watched the documentary last night. I got a chance to finally watch it last night, and it was incredible. But Jaren's in it, right? He's in it at the end, and they kind of talk about the transition from Mike and Mark leaving and then the new generation coming in with Jaren and those guys. And they interview Jaren. And he even talked about a moment that I've loved. I'm interested to hear Blevins talk about it. Remember when Jaren had the huge game his rookie season against the Brooklyn Nets, and he hits all those threes, he leads them to an overtime win, and it's just a big moment for Jaren early in his career, and gets to the locker room, everybody's having a good time cheering everything, and Mark walks in and kicks a trash can over, and everybody's like, what? Whoa! Yes. What's going on? And it's because Mark didn't think they played the right way and didn't think they should have to lean on a rookie to, you know, get him a win in overtime against the Brooklyn Nets. So I do think there might be something to that as far as, like you say, inspiration. Like, he kind of saw that, and maybe – and he even acknowledged, like, at the time, didn't really understand it.
Right.
Why Mark was acting like that.
Playing just as hard during the regular season.
Right.
And even a lost regular season, if you will, so that when you are in a postseason opportunity – and now Jaren is – he's still young as hell, and that's the beautiful thing about the Grizzlies. But here's a player who's 19 by his side in Gigi Jackson, who has a double-double last night, and is able to learn – from the play of these guys the rest of the way. And I think there's really something to be said about, like, the desire to be on the court. And we saw it with Desmond Bane, who's now missed a couple of games with back soreness. But him even coming back from his injury, period, with the ankle injury in a season where the Grizzlies aren't trying to win games. But, like, just having that added desire, having Jaren Jackson Jr. hit that 65-game mark and still going out last night and putting on a show and looking like the most talented player on the court in a game that featured Giannis Antetokounmpo, it's exciting. And you throw in the Brandon Clarke of it all, and there's actual tangible reasons why yesterday's game meant something. And I have been perfectly clear on my stance of Jaren Jackson Jr. as the starting five for this team, the full-time starting five, because we've seen it, and I am a believer of let someone be the best version of themselves. Like, don't put someone in a forced situation because it's what you think could maybe be best for you. Like, we've established Jaren's best. But by God, if there's anything that makes me question it just a little bit, it's seeing Jaren Jackson Jr. and Brandon Clarke, and we will continue, but first Bennett Doyle has to get his cup of coffee. I wish we had some, like, royal music coming in, because Bennett has been delivered a cup of coffee. This is teamwork. It makes the dream work. You're the best. Bennett, you're going to survive. You're going to make it. You're going to make it through the rest of the morning.
I'm good.
Take that first sip of your coffee.
Let's do this show now.
Can we get one sip of coffee?
Huh?
Can we get one dramatic sip of coffee?
It's probably really hot.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Are you any man?
I'm feeling good.
Oh, my God.
I'm feeling great.
Welcome.
I'm feeling like Marc Gasol.
I'm
feeling like Jaren. Let's go.
All right. What do you think when you see Jaren and Brandon out there together? And, like, have you ever heard that it's bad luck to cheers water?
Yeah, but I don't buy
that. That's what my husband tells me all the time.
No. You know why I don't buy that? Because now, like, you know, then you'll know this as a West Coast person.
Sure.
Like, now you know how people do wine tastings?
Yes.
Like, you know, people are steering away from, not everyone's drinking anymore because it's bad for your skin, all that kind of stuff. So now people are doing water sommelier tastings.
Oh.
And so you're tasting, like, different, unique waters. So I think it's okay.
Does Memphis get involved? Can you imagine sitting down at, like, a water sommelier tasting? And it's like, here's the freshest glass of Memphis water you could have ever asked for.
If that's not a thing, we should, keep that. Right, yeah, keep that a secret.
Keep
that a secret. That's
pocket.
A good idea right there. So, yes, cheers.
I would just like to cheers modern medicine.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to cheers the advancement of rehabilitation, because once upon a time, a bouncy athlete like Brandon Clarke would tear his Achilles, and you would be sincerely worried that that was the end, that there would be no way that he could ever return to a fraction of 100%. And I'm not saying Brandon Clarke's at 100%. Like, let's pump the brakes. However, he is far better and looks far more comfortable than I ever imagined him to be three games back from tearing his Achilles just over a year ago.
No doubt. Like, I literally, all I wanted to see this season was to was for him to look like his old athletic self. I didn't care about the box score, the numbers, none of it. I just wanted to see him on the floor running up and down the court and looking like his old athletic self. And he's far exceeded that. Like, he looks like he looks like old BC. He looks like he's ready to just be inserted right back into this lineup. I don't think that's something anybody expected to see this season.
And he has such an opportunity to grow confidence mentally. Like, that is the biggest thing. He can now go into this offseason and be like, all right, been there, done that. I've been in a game. I've taken the falls. I've done everything that could possibly be asked of me in a real game situation. And now I can just focus on continuing to build strength up, continuing to build the bounce back up. And thinking about it from a standpoint of, like, where we could be with Jaren and BC next year, there is something very, like, tingly in the jingly about those two on the court, those two bigs in particular on the court, and the plus that you get from that with the Grizzlies. I'm not saying it's the full-time answer, but when you think about the versatility of a closing lineup, we started to see trickles of it, and everyone was like, God, I wish I could see more reps of Jaren and Brandon on the court at the same time. And now we're getting a little bit of that, and it looks pretty damn good.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, it's the most successful playoff lineup they've had with this iteration of the Memphis Grizzlies. And so it also, just going into the offseason, I think it, you know, kind of centralizes what exactly you need to do as an organization as far as, you know, filling out this roster to compete for a championship next season. Because I think that before BC came back, you're still just not sure of what the big depth is going to look like coming into next season at all. I mean, regardless of who they draft, if they draft a rookie center, I still don't think that, and I've heard Rose and Vernon talk about this too, like, I still don't think coming into next season with a rookie center, even if they were starting next to Jaren, I don't think that that's a complete Memphis Grizzlies roster, right? Like, I think you still need that veteran rebounder, whether it's a forward, a center, something
capital
like that.
R rebounder.
Yeah.
Like, just get them in there.
Yeah, and now that you have BC back, I think that it makes it a little bit easier on the front office to just make decisions because you've got a little more depth. You've got one of your main guys back, and so it's big going into next year. It's big going into the offseason.
Well, and we talked yesterday coming out of that Nuggets Spurs game, where particularly in the West, because in order to make it to the NBA Finals, you have to get through the West, and there's going to be such an emphasis on, like, do you have something that can minimize or at least neutralize Jokic? Do you have something that can compete with Victor Wembanyama? And if you have a front court partnership where I think the versatility and how many different looks you can throw out with a front court can be just as big of an advantage of having, like, your own. You're not going to have your own Wemby. There's not another one of those out there. The closest thing you have is maybe Chet and Jokic, and, like, those guys exist in their respective markets right now. But you do have Jaren Jackson, and that goes back to the Jaren of it all. And it is very exciting to see him continue to grow. This is the highest usage rate of his career. It is, I believe, second most games he's played in a season since becoming an NBA player. And so you see someone who is learning how to make it through seasons healthily, and we knock on wood and we cross all the fingers and toes because we know what Memphis has been through throughout this year. But seeing the advancement offensively, like, he's not going to have to be that next year, but the fact that you have that as an option alongside Ja, alongside Desmond Bain, gives you just added reason. I don't know how you can watch the Memphis Grizzlies right now and not think, oh, there's one, chalk up one more team that is going to be in the race for the Western Conference next season.
Oh, yeah.
I live with a Golden State Warriors fan. He says it all the time.
No, they're like, gonna be in the mix. There's just no doubt about it. If they're fully healthy coming in next year, they're going to be, I mean, I think they're going to be in that top six, just right back in it. So,
a lot of
stuff to be excited about in this dreadful season, I think. Which you can't say that about most teams around the league. Like, for the, you know what I mean? Like,
what are you, the Detroit Pistons trying to get excited about 50 points from Malachi Flynn. Although that was wild.
That was cool and random as hell. Yeah, it reminded me of who was it? I think Terrence Ross had a 50-point game for the Raptors once upon a time. I remember it happened the night of a Grizzlies game.
And he averaged 7 points for the Raptors that season. Malachi Flynn has been averaging 5. So this is the unlikeliest 50-point game that we've ever seen in the NBA. Malachi Flynn of Tacoma, Washington. Shout out Tacoma.
Shout out.
Started at Washington State, ended at San Diego State before being taken in the first round, 29th pick overall by the Raptors, and then obviously ends up with
that
the Pistons.
That is crazy. Corey Brewer had a 50-point game.
Sure
That's
did.
Wild. That he's an assistant coach for the Pelicans now, I think.
Is he?
I think so. I know he's an assistant coach.
I was just thinking about
crazy,
because there's
man.
Been so much focus on that Florida team that decided to run it back with Horford and Noah and Corey Brewer, and if UConn can be the next to do it, you look back on that Florida team was so.
They were awesome.
That
they
was the
were
year
awesome.
I fell in love with Joakim Noah as a young girl watching the Florida
Gators.
Joakim
Noah. Shout out Grizzlies legend.
Shout out Grizzlies legend. The best. No, that's not true. I can't definitively say it was like the best press conference moment because we've had some pretty good press conference moments. Mm-hmm. And like I was at the Take That for Data press conference in San Antonio.
They're not going
to rook us. That
it lost a little bit of
be.
Its luster
it
over time.
It,
yeah,
it sure did.
Sure.
But being at the one where I think it was it Bickerstaff who just said, Joe Kim's effing crazy?
I think
randomly
so.
In
yeah,
the
yeah,
like,
I think so.
Joe Kim's effing crazy. I was like, yes, definitively. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Grizzlies get a win over the Bucks last night. They now come home for a back-to-back this weekend. They play the Pistons on Friday. They will play the Sixers. Joel Embiid and the Philadelphia 76ers coming in on Saturday. But that is Marc Gasol jersey retirement night. 33 will go in the rafters. And if you have not watched the Marc Gasol documentary, what are you doing? But that's okay. If you have, you know it's awesome. Michael Blevins, the director of that documentary, is going to join us in studio to share some stories from it on the other side. Hey, Grizzlies fans, turn your stadium excitement into betting action at Southland Casino Hotel. As a proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies, Southland brings you more gaming action than ever before. Step onto our massive casino floor stretching more than 2.5 football fields. Slot enthusiasts can enjoy more than 2,300 machines from penny slots to high limits and play the hottest games like Aristocrat, Dollar Storm, Cloverlink, and Lightning Cash. Table game aficionados can feel the thrill of the felt with 50 live table games. From 3-card to blackjack match, we're ready to deal you in. Plus, don't miss stadium gaming for an interactive digital experience. And for high rollers, our high limit room is calling your name. Go big on 6 high limit blackjack tables or spin one of our 54 high stakes slot machines. Throw in 8 delicious dining options and a 300 room high rise hotel, and there's plenty to keep you going. At Southland Casino Hotel, the gaming excitement never stops.
Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Let's face it, there's a lot of trash talk in basketball, but the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard, a class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
Sauced by Will Smith is taking their championship taste to FedEx Forum. Come enjoy your favorite lineup of sauces on traditional and boneless wings the next time you see the Memphis Grizzlies play. All of your favorite sauces, including the famous Garlic sauce, are now available as you cheer the home team on. Visit Sauced by Will Smith inside FedEx Forum at your next Grizzlies game or come visit us anytime at our location in South Haven, Mississippi. Championship sauce, championship taste. Come get sauced today.
Now for a limited time, the new $1.99 Crispy Tender Wraps are here at Sonic. Who could deny a crispy chicken tender with bold flavors like Hickory Barbecue and Cheesy Baja? And we can't forget the crisp lettuce and melty cheese to make the perfect bite. Wrap yourself up with some TLC, tender, love, and chicken for only $1.99. Sonic $1.99 Crispy Tender Wraps. Tax not included, limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
Are you a healthcare professional looking for a new experience? Look no further than Travel Nurses, Inc. Our extensive network of healthcare facilities across the country offers you the opportunity to discover new destinations while pursuing your passion. We provide competitive compensation, flexible contracts, and dedicated assistance. So join our community of nurses and allied health professionals and start your next adventure today. Visit our website at travelnursesinc.com for more information.
Did you do anything in that St. Joe's game?
No, I was strictly playing defense. Delonte West was tough. That's a pro. Oh, my God. That step back.
Oh, wait, hold on. 40 minutes. You didn't even get a rest.
No, I played the whole game. 40,
6 for 11 from the field.
That was me.
12 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists.
Oh, I was nice that game. I thought I ain't getting double figures.
The Chris Vernon Show, presented by Caesars Sportsbook. Live weekdays at noon on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Did I invent this? Low-key?
Did you?
I spent years calling my ex-producer Cowboy Carson, and now Beyonce?
She decides
she wants to dabble in country, in the genre. Now she's calling her album Cowboy Carter.
When she's doing her next concert, and she says, hey, my new album's about to come out, Cowboy Carter.
Inspired by the Gary Parrish Show.
Shout out GP in Memphis.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Welcome back on this beautiful Thursday, a Thursday morning after a Grizzlies win. And as promised, Michael Blevins, director of Memphis Made, the Marc Gasol documentary, joins us in studio. Blevins, before we get into the documentary, I do have a trivia question for you and Bennett that Raghav in the chat brought up. Can you tell me who was picked directly after Malachi Flynn of 50-point fame last night from the Pistons? Who was picked right after Malachi Flynn in the draft? And I'm not telling you the year.
You're not telling me the year?
No.
Oh, Malachi Flynn. I'm going to say he's been in the league for a minute, right?
A minute?
Yeah, he's been in the league
for... A cup of coffee, if you will.
Is it a superstar? It's a superstar, isn't it?
I think so.
It's a superstar.
I think so.
Shay?
No.
I got nothing. I got nothing.
Think closer to home.
Closer to home.
Mm-hmm.
Was he a lottery pick? Was Flynn?
No. 29th pick.
X or BC?
29th. Des Bane.
There you go.
There you go. Okay.
29 teams passed on Desmond Bane, only for the Memphis Grizzlies. Yes, 2020 draft, Malachi Flynn went 29th. He went ahead of Jaden McDaniels, Duka Azubuike, Peyton Pritchard, Emmanuel Quickley, RJ Hampton. Who's Leonardo Balmaro? Anything? All right. That's your 2020 end of the first round draft coverage of the morning. Anyway, Blevins, it has been such a fun week seeing all of the response to the Marc Gasol documentary, something that you worked extensively on. How many hours total do you think went into the creation of this documentary?
I think post-production wise, I mean, we're talking maybe 1,000, something like that. We waited for a lot of the interviews to get done because it's kind of hard with something like this because it wasn't the goal kind of with Mark's was different from Zeebo's. Where Zeebo's, when I was putting it together, I was like, this is a story of revenge and redemption, right? Revenge against the Clippers for discarding him, redemption with everything he had gone through. And with Mark, I wanted to get more like a nuance, like you're watching it and you're going to understand everything about him. And you're going to understand why he got that in his ring and why people in Memphis care that he got that in his ring at the end, right? So with that, as we were getting interviews, like, they were going everywhere in the project. So it was a little tougher. I think I started editing probably into January lightly and then heavy duty into the first week of February.
What was the first interview you did? Do you start with Mark or was it someone else?
No. Well... It started, me and him were talking, and I was like, because I joked with him last time when Z-Bo got his jersey retired, and I was escorting him around and everything. Because it was only like me and a couple other people he told he was going to come to the game for that, right? And I was joking like, hey, you might be next. And he's like, I'm still playing. And I joked, what are you going to play till like your Kareem, like 45, just so you don't have to get your jersey retired?
So he doesn't have to do a long interview.
Yeah, he doesn't have to do anything with it. Or see anything about him. And I think, and then we talked a little bit in the summer because I was like, I just want to warn you, we're going to start getting interviews for this. Because we've gotten interviews for Tony. We've gotten interviews that, you know, eventually that we'll use in mics. Just when you get somebody, like we got Hubie Brown. We asked him a bunch of questions. Right. We can use a bunch of different things. So I was like, hey, just so you know, I'm going to ask, I think Nick Nurse was the first interview. I'm going to ask Nick Nurse for an interview in Utah. And then we're going to get some people in Vegas. Is there anybody in particular? And he didn't say anybody different than we were planning. And then we got him. He was probably like the sixth interview because Vegas was Mike, Z-Bo, Danny Green, Chris Wallace. I think that's it in Vegas. And obviously Nick Nurse in Utah, the summer league before that. And then we got Mark in Springfield when we went to cover Powell's jersey retirement. We rented out a suite at the casino that's up there and interviewed him. It was originally supposed to be only like 45 minutes, ended up being 2 hours. And every person we've told that knows Mark is like, I can't believe he did an interview for 2 hours.
The second you start the interview, did you get a feeling that he was in a place where like he was ready to open up, or do you feel like you had to... Like, were you hoping, like, oh, how are we going to get 45 minutes out of this? Or were you immediately like, oh, this is going to go 2 hours?
I think, so I was putting together, typically when I put together the questions, and it helps because I'm editing it, too. I'm answering the questions I'm editing. Mm-hmm. I want it in sort of an order for everybody, right? Mm-hmm. But I knew there were some questions, like Mark back in the day probably wouldn't have loved talking about, right?
Right.
So I placed them in certain spots in there. But I think probably, like, 10 minutes into it, because he started from, you know, when they moved over, blah, 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 and he was all about it. And sometimes I'll catch myself because they don't hear me asking the questions typically, right?
Yeah.
So yours is a little bit different world. Where I'm just like, bam, bam, bam.
Right.
And I'll do it with our players where it's like, I don't want to waste your time, so I ask them questions. And then I realize, like, God, they're having to do, like, a sprint, like a medley relay between each question. But, yeah, I mean, he was... I think from the get-go, it was like, oh, we got something special here. I think he was really, when you're doing a documentary about somebody like that, their interview is the driving force. Mm-hmm. You know what they want to talk about, what they want to focus on and everything. His was the backbone of everything.
And then you fill out everything else
around
it. One of the players you didn't say you got at Summer League, but who was in it, Kevin Durant. Where did you interview KD?
We interviewed him downstairs. we had put the we had gotten Chris Paul for Z-Bo's, and Chris Paul had a great interview. This is when he was on Phoenix. A great interview with us for Tony.
Mm-hmm.
And we requested Kevin Durant for Tony's. And then... You know, as we're going through it, it's going great. He is like the nicest guy, and he just loves basketball. And he was so like, we told him Tony's, and then I gave him the box score from the Grit Grind game, right? Because the original Grit Grind game was against them.
Right.
And he had a laugh about that and then asked a few questions, and I'm like, over return marks too. And he goes, oh, that's awesome. Those guys, like, the four of them, I've said it before, like, there's just a respect, especially with the superstars, because it feels like, those four guys earned everything, right?
Yeah.
And they were never disrespectful. There was never issues, except for Z-Bo with that one player, famously. but there was just respect with those guys. So when I told him about Mark, like, he was like, oh, yeah, I'll do a question.
Right.
And this was like, you'll understand this as a media member. He didn't play in the game, but still he had to do stuff before the game. It was like 45 minutes before tip.
Wow.
Which, like, players don't do stuff.
It's a rarity, for sure. And I loved, you know, when he starts talking about it. And I hear this about Kevin Durant all the time.
Yeah.
He's just the nicest guy who just wants to talk about basketball all the time. And there's this, like, deep respect for great basketball and successful basketball and how that can be even without a ring. And to hear Kevin Durant float around the word dynasty, and we get so territorial about our usage of the word dynasty, and it is always attached to teams that have won at least a championship, usually multiple championships. But the fact that he's even willing to enter that territory, I thought was so indicative of the imprint that these four had.
And I think, not to get into too much Durant stuff because I'm not the person to speak about him, but I think he brought up the idea that they were dynasty because they were together for that long, right?
Yeah.
And this happens. I think a lot of his stuff is overblown with the media and stuff because he's such a high-profile player. I worked for four different organizations and a college one. It's hard to keep a team together. Mm-hmm. And it's not just, like, playing well and doing all that stuff. It's hard to keep a band together. How many bands do we know break up and stuff like that? So I think he looks at it with that prism where he's been on different teams, and it's hard to keep it together and everybody pulling the rope the same way. And from the outside and on the inside, those four of those dudes never let go of that rope.
Was there a part of the documentary as you are either conducting the interview or starting the editing process where you get that, like, director buzz where you just know, oh, people are going to react so positively, or just have a reaction period to this?
The first thing was an idea. So a lot of the times I'm it's just a matter of me doing the keyboard and mouse, where I have it already in my head. The hardest thing is, like, the stuff that doesn't go in order. So, like, the Mark competitor stuff, I knew I wanted to do a segment. It's like, where do I put that? Open Arms to St. Jude, where do I put that? But there's certain things where, like, oh, here's a little magic trick I could do. The one I really liked, and no one's really talked about, is, like, the first thing in the film is you hear my voice asking him what a Memphian is. Mm-hmm. And then I'm like, I need to find a clip. So the last one is him saying, I'm a Memphian, right? So you go 1 hour and 43 minutes, and it's like, well, this is what a Memphian is. And then I think just finding the song that's used three different times in there, like the beginning, the 2013 one, and then at the very end was a big one. But I thought, yeah, when Jeff Calkins has that line about what they meant to the city, and I was like, oh, that's going to stitch perfectly with the Durant one. I thought, oh, yeah, that's going to be cool.
For you, like, as a director of a documentary, did you always want, was the goal eventually to make documentaries?
Yeah, so it's funny you asked that. I was a terrible student at LSU. All I wanted to do was work. Terrible student. Most people are terrible at LSU for different reasons, which I was more so my freshman year. Okay. Like, there's fun things to do
at the party side of it.
Yeah. But I just wanted to work. And I switched majors like three times, and then I switched to general studies, right? So all those anybody watching right now, you got general studies degree, or you want to get general studies degree, you can do whatever you want, right?
Yeah.
You work in sports. I'm sure there's plenty. Yeah, it's general.
General is very wide.
But I had to petition because it was like a bunch of things I didn't want to do. I just want to work and then do classes that are easy for me. So then I had to petition three minors for it, right? And it was kinesiology, sociology, film studies. And I had to write a paper to the dean. I was like, I want to make, like, sports documentaries, and kinesiology, you're learning about sports studies, blah, blah, blah. Film, you're learning about film. And sociology, you're learning about the people, right? Mm-hmm. And you're learning about what makes people tick, what makes societies tick, different stuff like that. And I was like, that's very important because you're going to be doing stories about people that you would have never encountered when you're younger. You've never gone through the stuff they've gone through. So, yeah, I don't remember that professor's name, but I appreciate him approving that.
What was your favorite sports documentary of all time? Like, what were your inspos?
It's tough. Honestly, my favorite thing we were talking about before we got on air, what I like to do, like, before I do an intro video. Mm-hmm. I like to, like, watch something, like, really high end. So, like, I was working on the intro video and then Beyond Grits before the season and the Tony Allen hype video we did. And I'm like, I'm going to see the Scorsese film, Flower Moon.
Yeah, Killers of the Flower Moon.
I was like, I need to go watch that. That'll give me
great opening scene.
That'll give me tickets. Yes. And then, like, I'll do that with, I really like Tarantino, so I'll watch Tarantino. And then for this one, I watch, my favorite documentary ever is the Kurt Cobain montage of Heck One. That's my favorite.
Good choice.
And he's my favorite documentary maker because, again, I did the opposite in this. He doesn't use a bunch of sound bites. He doesn't use a bunch of interviews. He uses a bunch of footage. They use some animation, which we did too. And then for the other inspiration, as it was going on, I was rewatching The Sopranos. And because I like The Sopranos, it's high end. And it's also was, I knew in this documentary, I wanted every detail to be there for a reason. And you're like learning this thing about Mark, or you're learning a little one is like the pyramid was empty when he was going to games. And it kind of made him sad, right? Mm-hmm. So then when he comes here and it's full with towels and everything, you understand why he gets emotional when he talks about that. And The Sopranos, it's like, oh, Carmella did this. So that means once they have that fight, you're past that point.
Well, right? Even, yes. So I just watched, I'm halfway through the last season of The Sopranos. I'm half of an episode away from being halfway through with it. But Carmella and Ro just went to Paris together. Ro seems like a
Carmella, why are you talking about all that stuff? Yeah. We're here in Paris.
Why do we want to talk about my dead son? I want to go out with a hot young Parisian man. But you think about it but that's how The Sopranos works. I think that's such a good point because immediately my brain is like, okay, what is this impact in Carmella's journey and her relationship with Tony? And Tony's not there, and you never see them. Suddenly I'm thinking, you've never seen this family take vacations. How difficult it must be as mafia members to take, God, just get a vacation every now and then.
You know why it's difficult to go on vacation?
Because you might not come back.
Well, also because Carmella's just going to be a downer the entire time.
Not too.
I rewatched, I want to promote the movie and everything.
Yes, of course.
But I rewatched the podcast Michael Imperioli and I think Steve Stripper, whoever has
Talking Sopranos.
Yeah.
So good.
It's so good.
And David Chase. Usually when I watch a thing, like Aaron Sorkin, I could tell has a complicated relationship with women in his life based on his characters.
Yes.
Chase was tough to tell because nobody looks good in that series. But he is not a fan of Carmella. When he talks about the interviews, he's like, she's the only mob wife like this where it's like, you're going to hell, Tony, and then why are we doing this, and where's my diamond ring at the same time?
No, all of a sudden, there's like a shift of the morality of it where she's like, but I really want my Porsche.
He has no respect for her.
I really want this Louis Vuitton purse you just gave me with $15,000 in it to take off my
vacation. Where's the bird feeder with the money in it?
I'd say he has a complicated relationship with women because of all of the Freudianism with Tony's mom and with his sister and obviously through therapy.
We can do a whole thing on that.
We can have a whole off-season conversation about The Sopranos. Grind City Media presents Sopranos rewatch. I would do it all over again. But when it comes to like your inspiration, I think that's so interesting. The sociology class in college is perfect. I think more journalism majors should take sociology classes because you're right. You end up talking to so many different people. Is there anyone who you really wanted to talk to for this documentary who it just didn't work out for whatever reason?
We tried to get some of the Spanish national team. I mean, it's a dilemma when you're doing this because we didn't want, during Zeebo's, it was like COVID, so we were just kind of limited. Like Doris Burke's interview, ESPN had to shoot in, they had to shoot on ESPN cameras. Okay. And again, for people that are not in the weeds, like those cameras look very different. So the only ones we wanted were willing to do Zoom were the open arms. Everybody associated with that. We didn't want to do a bunch of overseas like that. I think Rick Rubio would have been really good. He's back overseas. A couple of those. I mean, the dilemma with the Spanish national team is like, it's not easy to get photos and footage from it.
Yeah.
Because you cover the Olympics. Yeah, it's they guard impossible. That pretty strict.
It's like under lock and key.
But there's not a lot. I mean, there's a lot with Tony. I'm already thinking in my head about Tony's. I want to get. But again, like those four guys, Tony's story will be a little bigger and have a little more depth and about his journey and who he is. But with those four guys, honestly, it's not important to get like Joel Embiid for Mark. Like, do we really, like, is that going to add to the story? I don't think
so. Not necessarily. Someone in the chat said they wanted to hear from Project Pat.
Project Pat would have been interesting because we got Yo Gotti and Moneybagg for Zeebo's. But I think we tried and it wasn't going to work out.
It doesn't surprise you at all. We were talking about this off air, but Mark hasn't watched the documentary. Do you think he will ever watch the documentary?
I think he told me he was very excited and eager to see it. But it was going to be very difficult. I forget what the exact phrasing was. I'll see him today. We were joking about it. I'm sure we'll see him today, and people are going to talk to him about it. And eventually he's just going to know that everything's in the documentary. Because eventually, like, he was on Vernon and stuff, and it's like, hey, that story you're telling right now is in the documentary. Like, we already know it, right? He did the Frasier thing up here.
That was so funny.
It made it even more funny because everybody on Twitter is like, oh, we know. We heard the stories. We heard the Escalade going through Frasier.
When are you doing this, like, Beyonce Renaissance? Are you going to tell us at the end that all these documentaries fit perfectly together, like one segs into the next, and you can just tee them up, 1, 2, 3, 4?
I've thought about that, honestly. I think, knock on wood, we win a championship and we do something like that. I think the Mark one and the championship one should link really well, just because where one stops and where one goes. I think that would. Because, I mean, like, people are saying this is a documentary about grit and grind. I think, I mean, people can, it's done. They can, you know, it's not up to me how it's interpreted. But I think it's more about who Mark is. And he was all about that. It's so funny. I don't know if I told this. I may have told this on the panel. There's just a few interview bites we can't use. And I think maybe I posted this one on Twitter. He was just very, like, sharing with the ball, right? Mm-hmm. Like, he didn't want to be the guy. But he said in the interview, and I had told some of his former teammates, they laughed really hard at it, is like, he was like, I wish we would have shot more. When I needed to, I wish we would have shot more. And especially those last couple of years, he was just trying to get everybody else going. But yeah, hopefully it fit his personality, and knock on wood, those two could be stitched together.
Yeah, and within his personality too, even when you hear him reflecting on winning Defensive Player of the Year, he's like, I don't understand individual awards. This is a team thing. And that kind of goes for the documentary side of it and the core four and the singular jersey retirement at a time. Like, this is a collective. One does not have the same impact without the other three. And I think that's a very special place to come from. I can't wait. I love the championship parade. If you can get it to exist outside of the cartoon. Who did the animation for that?
Ben. I'm going to mispronounce his name, so I'm not even going to try it. I think I tweeted it out. Artist, I think he's in New York. And we had Courtney for my crew had shot with the drone out there, and he was like, oh, I could just stitch right in there.
Oh,
and then
cool.
We're like, let's widen Beale Street a little bit, just so all the buses, because I don't know if that theoretically would happen. That question came about because I was like, I want Mark to emotionally speak about why he wanted to win a championship. And I was just kind of rambling, and hopefully he could take one of the questions. And I was like, you know, when I think about it, I think about how we would film it.
Right.
And I've thought about that, especially the one you were in the second round. Like, where we put cameras there? Where are they going to decide the parade goes? Does it go near the Civil Rights Museum? Does it go down by the river? All that stuff. And then he's like, oh, this is how I would do it. And then just like that. And
he so clearly has.
It would be special if,
about it.
If whenever that day happens, that those four guys are involved somehow.
I think it would almost be a must.
Yes. I think. Let's put him at the back because of what Zeebo said he would be like in the parade and what the video evidence shows Mark would be in the parade, like the far back. That was it. That was Mark's issue, he said. He's like, I was the last bus. So, like, all the people were behind me. Like, I was stuck having to catch all the beers.
You know? Yeah. Beers, you're not going to waste them.
No.
It's a victory parade beer. Well, anyway, Blevins, congratulations. Truly, you and your team did a phenomenal job. Every time I get on X, there's a new tweet of somebody who just watched the documentary. It's like, oh, my God, this took me back. This had the best memories of Memphis. This reminded me of a story that I forgot from long ago. This gave such a complete picture of who Marc Gasol is as a person and as a Memphian. So mission accomplished.
The hope is everybody's excited. I mean, they didn't need the documentary to get excited for Saturday, but hopefully that, like, reminds everybody of the importance. I think it'll be a special night. Powell will be there, Zeebo, Tony. Mike's not going to be able to because of logistics stuff, but we'll have a cool video with him. There'll be more cool videos in it. We got tickets, I believe, still available. So everybody, get your tickets, show up. I think it's going to be one of those nights. You were there for Zeebo's, right?
Yeah.
It's going to be one of those nights where it's in the Mount Rushmore of nights at the FedEx Forum, I think.
There's so much, like, you just feel it radiating within. They mean so much, understandably, to the city. And that's where I will push back. Like, do you have to have a documentary? No. But does it do a wonderful job of creating context for either people who were too young or who weren't here? I mean, we talked, like, I got here in 2016, and so I know, and I had a general sense of basketball and the Grizzlies' position within the NBA and the core four. But, like, you don't know, much like the city of Memphis as a whole, you don't understand this city until you live here yourself, until you experience it yourself. But a documentary does a really good job of guiding you along the way.
And we do such a good job. Again, we work here, so
We can say.
I would like to think I'm not blowing smoke about us.
Sure.
But it's like, I'm on the road with the team, and I'm there for some of these jersey retirements. And this is no offense to the players or their jersey retirements. I'm sure they have reasons for this. A lot of them are just like halftime. And it's like, bam, 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 it's done. So, like, this could be post-game. I was there at the rehearsal last night. This thing's going to be special. And I think, as a for documentary, for my sake, if the person's good enough to get their jersey retired, they're good enough for a documentary.
Blevins, we will see you next time. If you have not watched Memphis Made, the Marc Gasol documentary, highly, highly suggest you do so. It's up on the Memphis Grizzlies YouTube page, and you can find it all over social media as well. We will take a quick break. Bennett and I will be back on the other side with dreams of a Grizzlies championship parade, who Bennett would be in a future Grizzlies championship parade. We got to talk about the new college football Super League. We got to talk about UConn almost not making it to Arizona for the Final Four. And we are doing a draft day. We are drafting the 2024 movies we are most excited about still to come out this year. You don't want to miss it. We'll be right back.
I'm 10 feet ahead of you. Catch me or something you'll never do. I turn around and I level you. No motivation is needed. Look, I put myself on the pedestal. This is incredible.
Take your fandom to the next level with the official Grizzlies app. Go all access and behind the scenes.
It's got to be heavy defense. That's where it starts for us.
Personalized to where you are and who you are. Get easy access to ticketing, the game day guide, and your own app customization right at your fingertips. Upgrade your experience and download the Grizzlies app today.
Let's face it. There's a lot of trash talk in basketball. But the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard. A class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at lifecareamb.com.
It's more fun to be there live to see the Memphis Grizzlies hit the court all season long. From the electricity in FedEx Forum to the highlight reel plays, there's nothing quite like Grizzlies basketball. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you in with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands while you still can. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. That's Ticketmaster.com.
Vince Williams is going to go to All-Star Weekend. Now, what a great thing for him.
Kudos to Vince Williams Jr. You know, he was an injury replacement on the Panini Rising Stars. He'll get a chance to be part of the All-Star Weekend Showcase.
Hey, Grizzlies fans, be sure to tune in to Grizzbeat, where the panel and I break down all things Grizzlies and take a look at the rest of the NBA as well. The show is live every Wednesday, 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Students, get back to the grind and cheer on your Memphis Grizzlies at FedEx Forum. Don't miss out on our exclusive student ticket program presented by Big River Steel. Get affordable tickets for all the major showdowns, including matchups against the Lakers, 76ers, Nuggets, and more. Sign up today to get alerts about this exclusive ticket deal at grizzlies.com/students.
Movies. I'm just going to sprinkle this out into the atmosphere. Next week, CJ and I are debuting a new intro video for the show.
What?
Uh-huh. Season 2 on the Jazzy Best Show with CJ Hurt gets a new intro video.
This is a real TV show.
Sure is. Thanks to Courtney Williams for Blevins talks about like the organizational process down there and having so much footage. And as I'm watching the Marc Gasol documentary, all I can think of is shout out to whoever was organized enough from the jump to have all of that video footage in a space where you were able to actively go through it. Couldn't be me. Could not be me. But that's what Courtney Williams does for this beautiful show and keeps all of our best moments of dancing and making snow angels and doing squats and whatever else you might find along the way. If you were in the victory parade, Bennett, would you be the drunkest boy at the party?
I'd like to think so. Yeah.
I would like to imagine, but I feel like we would have to be to a level of decorum because we didn't win a championship.
That's true. And I mean, I'd probably be working in some form or fashion now that I'm, you know, with the organization. So it's probably not a good idea.
I'd like to shake. I just want to shake a champagne bottle. Like my dream is to be on a double decker bus. Please make this happen, Memphis Grizzlies, at some point. I just want to be on top of a double decker bus, double fisting two champagne bottles, shake, Sonora, and then pop, and then the champagne goes everywhere. And then you're like,
that would be fun. That would be fun. Oh, man, I hope it happens one day. I hope it happens while I'm still relatively young. I mean, that's young.
What does that word mean? Yesterday I was fine. I want to be perfectly clear. I left the show. Everything was good. I get home around like 4 o'clock from mentoring yesterday, and suddenly I have this like small twinge in my back. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, that's uncomfortable. And within the next 2 hours, I'm like, did I throw out my back? And it still hurts this morning. And my calf hurts because I did some jump ropes. You get old quick, but you're never too old for a championship parade. And we could beat the Bucks. That's what I'm taking away.
I'd love
in
to
this
play them in the finals.
Moment. Yeah, Jaren Jackson Jr. would love to play them in the finals.
Yeah.
I saw Mark Giannotto tweeted out Jaren's stats against the Bucks in his last 6 games. A 43-point game with 9 threes, a 29-point game with 4 blocks, a 36-point game with 3 blocks, where he was 5 of 6 from 3, and then last night's 35-point, 4 assists, 3 steal game. So, yes.
That's insane.
Sign me up. That means the Bucks have to somehow get to the finals from the East in this future hypothetical universe, and they might need to learn how to play defense first, but that's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. All right, 2 sports stories that we have to get to before we get into our 2024 movie draft. Oh, one thing Grizzlies related that I realized we didn't know, so I lied to you. 3 sports stories. I can confirm that my heart absolutely stops when Adrian Wojnarowski tweets the words Memphis Grizzlies star Ja Morant. I don't know if you had that experience yesterday, Bennett.
Okay, you know what? Did you watch The Office, the American version? Okay, well, there's like a famous gif of Stanley where he's like, why would you say it like that? And that's exactly what I thought when I said, bro, why are you wording the tweet like that? Like, it looks so grim, right?
Okay, see it. No. Let me push back on that. Does it look so grim? We're saying it looks so grim.
Or do we just have PTSD?
The simplest 5 words, Memphis Grizzlies star Ja Morant. It could be like, has announced that he rules the universe or has a new cool deal or is shockingly coming back for the grid. Like, we trend to the negative, and I understand why, because we do have PTSD, because the last, I would say, at least 75% of Woj updates surrounding Ja Morant have not exactly been on the positive side of things, whether it be injury-related or suspension-related, or there's always this lingering fear. I constantly forget how fragile, and I say fragile in like a kind way, a delicate way, like not as an insult, but we can all be so fragile here in assuming the worst for something. And my God, Grizzlies fans lost their collective mind. But I was glad to see that it was like this universal heart-stopping experience, whether no matter how you filled in the blank the rest of the way. But then you find out that it's just Ja Morant and his longtime agent Jim Tanner have parted ways, according to Adrian Wojnarowski. Tanner's been his agent since he came out of the draft. And I know some people immediately, everybody, like, take a chill pill. An agent change does not represent a seismic shift in the universe.
It's also, you know, I yesterday, I admit, was in one of those people that was like, oh, what does this mean? What is it? And then from talking to some people that know about this, they're just superstar athletes change agents all the time. Yeah, that's
non-super. I had 3 agents.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm nowhere near
right.
Superstar
so yeah, athlete. it's
the agency world operates differently, and it makes perfect sense. Like, I'm not going to sit here. I have no idea why John Morant decided to change agents. But there are very understandable reasons for someone to do that, such as John Morant understanding that his position as a player and as a persona, as a superstar in this league, might require, who knows, a younger agent, an agent that's connected in different parts of the industry that this one did not have. There are so many rational, very, very normal reasons for someone to do a change like this. So everybody is going to deep breathe in.
Yeah.
Breathe out. And it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
Did you read The Athletic's very fun report about a new super league in college football that has been proposed, Bennett?
I got the cliff notes. I got the cliff notes.
You skimmed. Yep, yep. You skimmed to find out that, according to this article, a proposition where the top 70 programs, all members of the major five conferences, plus Notre Dame and SMU. The fact that it has to go plus Notre Dame and SMU, SMU and your oil money, you will stay relevant forever for that reason and that reason only. But those would all be permanent members of this proposed Super League. All 130 FBS universities would be involved, but it would be in a matter of relegation. So there would be seven full-time 10-team divisions and then an eighth division where you would have teams who were promoted from that second tier. So you could be promoted or relegated based on your performance in a season. The NCAA will poof be gone. And according to this proposed idea from a group of 20 people, college sports will be saved. Yay! All you have to do is get to the second paragraph of this article to see that the plan has, quote, drawn skepticism. So it's not happening tomorrow, and it's likely not happening in this exact proposed format because you keep going through the article and it's like, well, the leagues have been hesitant. They've canceled meetings. They have not wanted to upset their TV partners. So the Big Ten hasn't met with this group. The SEC hasn't met with this group. The Big 12 hasn't met with this group. The ACC is like, yes, please sign us up for any meetings with anything that could possibly save what's going to happen at this conference with Florida State and Clemson being so disgruntled at this point. But the bottom line is there is this group of 20 people who they call themselves College Sports Tomorrow, the CST, and they're comprised of 20 leaders in sports, which includes the Syracuse chancellor, the West Virginia president, the second in command to Roger Goodell at the NFL, and then someone from the Sixers. My reaction, call me back when Greg Sankey and Tony Petitti answer the phone.
For sure.
I guess that's simple.
Yeah, I kind of got hung up on, because you said it would involve all the FBS teams,
sure.
But, wait, FBS, right?
FBS,
yes.
Yeah. Football Bowl Subdivision.
But then there was something in there about 80 teams that they said in the initial, you know, post about it, which I got hung up on a little bit because when you go and look through, you know, the Power Five conferences, I think you get to about 67 teams, 68 with Notre Dame. And so I was like, well, where does those other 12 teams come from?
So it's the 10 that would be promoted. Because it's
from the group, mid-majors.
The what has been the group of five will now be a slush fund of teams that are working. It's funny for me because at first I saw this, and I'm like, oh God, here we go again. College sports cannot get their shit together.
Right.
And then I saw the part about promotion and relegation, and I've been really intrigued by the European soccer model for a potential solution for college sports. And it was a few years back at this point, many years back, where early on in Greg Sankey's career as the commissioner of the SEC, he was asked like his summer reading list, and he went out of his way to talk about this book that was about the Premier League and the European soccer structure.
Yeah.
And so that always stuck in my mind where I was like, oh, that's what they're working towards. But I always thought it would be driven by the SEC and the Big Ten because, as we have expressed many, many times, like, they hold all the cards. Like, they are the power pushers in this. And a part of me wants absolute chaos where it's not just the 10 teams who get promoted, because those 70 teams, according to this, like, they're protected no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
They cannot be taken down. It is only the teams in the group of five who can move up, down, and all around. I want Oklahoma State to have to play for their lives. I want the Hunger Games of college football where there are actual stakes for some of these teams that, yes, have a lot of passion behind them. But let's take Vanderbilt, for example. I don't want to dunk on Vanderbilt. I hate that we dunk on Vanderbilt all the time, but they're perfect. Like, they don't have a marquee brand of college football. So play your way into the ones that matter year in, year out.
Right.
But with transfers, it makes it hard, because why would a quarterback go play at Vandy if they knew that they're not going to be able to play in the proposed big league of it all?
Yeah, I just, and the thing with relegation, why I just don't think it would work with college football, is you are essentially telling your fan bases, like, if you get relegated, hey, don't worry about buying season tickets this year. Right? You know, like, you're not going to get anybody on board with that from these group of five. And listen, again, I guess they're at the mercy of these Power Five conferences, whatever, but you're not going to get schools to agree on that, because, again, when you get relegated, I know it works there.
Right.
Here, I just don't see it, because, again, you're saying to your season ticket base, hey, we'll be back next year, you know? This season doesn't matter. So I just don't see how that works.
Yeah, you can't take away something that's already exists. Or it's very difficult to do that, because your mentals just can't adjust.
Right.
But good try, good effort. I really think this was a nothing burger of a story for now, but at least you know that there are wheels moving where people are like, hey, we're on a downhill spiral right now, and something's going to have to come in and sweep and save everybody from the chaos of it all. Last thing to get to in the sports world for today, the UConn Huskies, who have beaten teams by an average of 28 points this March Madness tournament, Bennett, almost didn't make it to Arizona in time for... They have media day today. Today is Thursday. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the games, the semifinals on the men's side begin on Saturday. Championship game is Monday. UConn heavily favored in their opening semifinal game against Alabama. Their plane had 8-plus hours of delays yesterday. And this is the first time they've had to fly this postseason, because all of their games were in the Northeast region, so they were able to bus to their first, second round, Sweet 16, Elite Eight games. And the other teams got to Arizona just perfectly fine. Alabama and Purdue got there Wednesday. NC State got there early Thursday. And UConn experienced what I'm sure every single one of us has experienced at least once in our lives, where they were sitting, waiting for a plane to take off that just wouldn't take off. Mm-hmm. And at one point, the crew was overworked, so they had hit the number of hours that they could legally fly, and so then they had to find another crew, and then it was a matter of, okay, we could take off now, but we would have to land in between and refuel, because everyone knows, gotta refuel.
Yeah, you do.
One time I landed in the middle of, where was I? Jackson, Wyoming, to refuel. It was crazy. Beautiful airport. Would have never been
really
there in any other way. Yeah, it was gorgeous.
Cool.
But it wasn't cool sitting there for 3 hours while they refueled.
Yeah, this just feels like the college football gods trying to level the playing field here.
I think so.
Yeah, yeah. Like, oh, you have an unfair...
Basketball gods.
I
do love the world where the UConn Huskies are playing for the college football playoff against Alabama, but we'll wait for another day.
This is just, like I said, college basketball gods evening the playing field. I don't think it's going to matter regardless. UConn's going to roll
the
title.
No, but Dan Hurley's press conference today is going to be amazing. Yeah. Probably. He uses everything as fuel. He is such a weirdo in the best way. I like him. He entertains the hell out of
me. He's wild.
But he is so strange, and he will take anything. And the NCAA posted the video of their plane landing at like 1:33 in the morning last night, and I was like, that was an interesting choice. I maybe wouldn't have. Ladies and gentlemen, we've landed. Thank you.
There it is.
Wait, they flew Allegiant?
Oh, how did I? That's why.
Is Allegiant a partner?
Oh, I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know.
Jacob says, no. Okay. We can make Allegiant jokes.
Thank God.
We're good.
God.
We're safe. We are safe in the world. Anyway, they made it. It'll be fine.
Give me an Aquafina.
Give me an Aquafina and a Chick-fil-A chicken sandwich.
Yes.
Immediately, please. And thank you. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we are drafting the movies coming out in 2024 that we are most excited about. I was prepping for this, and I was like, damn, this is going to be an awesome year for movies, or at least projects to be an awesome year for movies. Bennett and I will give our favorites when we come back.
Grizzlies fans know it's the team that gives you the edge. Big River Steel does too. That's why we're recruiting the best talent to help us develop the sustainable steel needed for today and tomorrow.
Join us at the edge of the future. Visit www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team. That's www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team.
We know there's only one team you want to watch, and Bally Sports is the place to get your Grizzlies. Experience the comebacks, the buzzer beaters, the can't-miss Memphis Made moments live. Bally Sports keeps the grind going before and after the game, too, with Pete, Brevin, Fish, and Chris on Grizzlies Live. Watch Grizzlies basketball all season long with Bally Sports and streaming on the Bally Sports app. Bally Sports, home of the only team you want to watch.
When it's all on the line, you turn to the strong, the stable, the unwavering, to those with a history of raising their performance to meet the moment. It's true in basketball. It's true in banking. Grizzlies checking from Pinnacle. Play hard, bank easy. Open a Grizzlies checking account with at least $100 and a recurring direct deposit by April 30th, and you could receive a $200 direct deposit bonus into your account. Details at grizzliesbanking.com. Member FDIC.
There was some sad news coming out of the WWE. Michael Jones, also known as Virgil, passed away. He's a Virginia Union alum, so he graduated from an HBCU. He got his start in Memphis, right?
Oh, man, you're absolutely right. He started in Memphis in 1985.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
Let's talk about some of the guys who get dunked on the most.
Mel Turpin. There's a great clip on YouTube, kids. Go look this up, where Michael Jordan gets the ball in the post, spins around John Stockton and dunks. As he runs down the court, a fan in Utah says, "Hey, pick on someone your own size." The next time down, Michael Jordan comes down. 7-foot-tall Mel Turpin's under the basket, and Jordan just hammers on him. And as he runs down the court, he turns to the fan and says, "Was he big enough?"
IMHO with Lane Whitaker and me, Kelsey Wright Johnson, on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
I think we have the college basketball title futures. UConn's number one.
I really like Houston. I'd have them winning it all, but you can't be giving Drake jerseys. What is wrong with you?
Maybe the Drake curse is stronger in college basketball.
Well, how long has he been riding with Kentucky?
He wore an Alabama jersey and Saban retired.
The Odds Couple with Rob Fisher, Lang Whitaker, John Roser, and CJ Hurt live Thursdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Welcome back. It is Thursday. It is draft day, and we are drafting 2024 movies. So the only criteria is that the movie has to come out between today and the rest of 2024, which does get a little complicated sometimes, Bennett, because there were some 2024 movies that got moved, including, are you familiar with the movie Mickey 17? Have you heard of
it?
This
isn't Paul Thomas Anderson.
No, it's the one done by the guy who did Parasite.
Bong Joon.
It was supposed to come out in 2024. It stars Robert Pattinson. It's about a guy who goes and is trying to socialize a ice planet, and he keeps dying. But even though his body has to regenerate, all his memories stay the same. It's supposed to be, it's like a sci-fi thriller. It's based on a book. It's no longer coming out in 2024. If you, like me, were excited for it to come out in 2024.
So I am excited.
That's a wrong.
I love Robert Pattinson, and I love that director. He is really good. If you've never seen it, he did a movie called, it's called like Okjo or something like that. Mm. And it's I don't even want to tell you what it's about. It's about a monster. I'll leave it at that.
Monsters. Yeah. I also love Toni Collette, and she's in that. That's like one of the random actresses that I always enjoy seeing in something, and I don't know why. Okay, do we have a coin flip, or are we just doing rock, paper, scissors?
Let's do rock, paper, scissors. Yeah. All right, here we go.
Rock, paper, scissors, shoot.
Let's go.
All right,
I'm going first. Okay, I'm going to start. Are we doing honorable mentions, by the way?
At the end.
Okay, good, because I have like a million honorable mentions.
Great.
Yeah, it was hard to
we'll
put this list together.
Day.
This is actually a good year for movies, I think. I'm going to go with a movie that actually comes out next week as my number five, and that is Civil War. This is the new Alex Garland movie, and it's basically about a a futuristic civil war in the United States of America.
A24 Hive standoff.
Yeah, new A24, a journey across a dystopian future America following a team of military-embedded journalists as they race against time to reach Washington, D.C. before rebel factions descend upon the White House. I love the director, Alex Garland. He did Ex Machina. He did Annihilation. Those are both really good movies. I think the trailers for this one look really good, and the early reviews say that they've been really positive. So I'm excited about this one. Civil War.
It's a good one.
You
I'm
like
excited
that one?
Because any movie that has Kirsten Dunst and her husband, Jesse Plemons, in it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It gets
good cast.
Me excited. Yep. And Kirsten Dunst has been crushing the PR tour of it all. I just really like Kirsten Dunst. She's one of
like
my favorite like, underrated
like
actresses out there. Did you ever see a movie when you were really young called The Devil's Arithmetic?
No.
It's a Holocaust movie, and they showed it to us in class.
Is she in it?
She is. She's in it, and R.I.P. Brittany Murphy's in it.
Okay, The Devil's Arithmetic.
Yeah.
I'm going to put that one down.
It messed me up when I was a kid.
Notes here. Okay.
Okay, with my first pick, I'm going to be strategic because I just want to make sure that you don't get this pick before me and you scare me. So I am going to take, with my number one pick, give me Francis Ford Coppola's Megalopolis. We have just started getting like the PR rollout for Megalopolis. We don't know a lot, but what we do know is it's supposed to be batshit crazy. That's what I've seen it defined as. Coppola is now 84 years old, and so choosing to come back and make this movie, this is a movie that he has wanted to make for a long, long time. So I was reading about the development of it, which made me even more excited for what it could be. And like, this is always, the premise of it is, in New York, a woman, Julia Cicero, is divided between loyalties to her father, Frank, who has a classical view of society, and her architect lover, Caesar, who is more progressive and wants to rebuild New York City as a utopia following a devastating disaster. It has Adam Driver, it has Forrest Whitaker, it has John Voight, it has Aubrey Plaza, it has Shia LaBeouf, which I'm not as excited about, but that's okay. The cast is stacked, but this is a concept, and when you hear Caesar and when you hear Cicero, one would imagine that there is like a Julius Caesar effect on all of it. And he came up with this concept during the filming of Apocalypse Now back in 1979. Mm-hmm. And he described it as a gigantic opera shown over four nights in some place as close as possible to the geographical center of the United States. And people would come from all over, as they do to Bayreuth. Coppola devoted the beginning of 1983 to writing the screenplay, assembling 400 pages of notes and script fragments in 2 months. In mid-1983, he described the plot as taking place in New York City, similar to how James Joyce's Ulysses used Homer in the context of modern Dublin. And eventually this flamed out because it seemed so big and so complicated that it would be impossible. And now we're getting it.
Okay, so this would have definitely been on my list, but I had no idea that it was coming out this year. For
they
some
just
reason,
announced that it's coming out this year.
Okay, for some reason I thought it was coming out next year. I'm really excited about this movie. I will say, obviously, Francis Ford Coppola is one of the greatest directors of all time. The Godfather, Apocalypse Now. He's done some amazing films. It's been a while. It's been a minute. Like, if you look at his filmography, it's been a minute since he's done a big-time box office hit. So this one's going to be really interesting. Like I said, the cast is great. So, yeah, I'm excited about that one. That's a good one.
Since The Rainmaker.
No, I had no idea Francis Ford Coppola directed Jack. What an amazing movie.
Yes.
Jack, Robin Williams. Oh, my God. Yeah. So that's a good one. I like that one. All right, my number four in my list is I feel weird about it now, but you'll see once we get. But my number four, this is going to be a big hit at the box office. Deadpool and Wolverine.
Nice.
I think that the reason I'm so excited about this one is I think Hugh Jackman's Wolverine is the greatest comic book movie character of all time. I loved all of those old X-Men movies, Days of Future Past. I loved him in Logan. The kind of, you know, that was kind of his goodbye to Wolverine, but he's bringing him back. Ryan Reynolds begged Hugh Jackman to come back and do this role for Deadpool 3. And we don't know a lot about it. We know Wolverine is recovering from his injuries when he crosses paths with Deadpool, and then they team up. And that's kind of interesting because it suggests, because spoiler alert, he died in Logan. And so it kind of suggests that this is going to be one of those time travel multiverse things. Somehow he's brought back, and Wolverine has regenerative powers, so maybe he just comes back on his own. But Deadpool and Wolverine, that's my number four. I can't wait for this movie. Love me some Wolverine.
Okay, I love that Hugh Jackman just randomly goes back and forth between either doing a musical or being completely cut to be Wolverine. Like, there is no in-between for right. Hugh Jackman at this point in his career. Like, I'm going to go do tap dance with the Music Man, and then I'm going to be ripped in this movie. Your list is going to be exactly the same as mine. My, like, biggest-brained movie pick of them all is Megalopolis. Everything else is very box office hitty.
So much
so that I will go with my number two pick. I genuinely, maybe the most excited to see this year, is Inside Out 2. The sequel to Inside Out from Disney Pixar. We entered the next phase of Riley's life. In the first one, she is 11 years old. Now we are moving into the teen years. We have been introduced to new feelings like anxiety and nostalgia and fear and disgust. I think Inside Out is one of my favorite Disney Pixar movies, and the way that it just so perfectly encapsulates, like, the absolute insanity that goes inside each and every one of our minds when we're dealing with all of those feelings ourselves, and the juggling of that through, like, adolescence and beyond. Mm-hmm. I hope they continue forward with Riley as she continues to grow up. I don't always love sequels, but when it's Disney Pixar, I've usually have not been disappointed by a sequel.
I completely agree. I didn't put And I'm excited about this movie, too. I didn't, out of principle, put that or Moana 2 on my list.
I did not put Moana 2 on my
and
list.
The reason being is because I'm kind of sick of Disney hitting us with all these sequels. Like, when we were kids, man, the sequels were just like the straight to VHS. Yeah, straight to DVD throwaway movies. And
no one liked sequels except for me and the Beauty and the Beast
The Christmas special. Yeah, and so I'm kind of sick of them doing this. Like, bring back original ideas.
But don't you think Toy Story broke that?
Yeah,
because all of the Toy Stories have been so good.
The sequels have been so good, and that's why they keep doing this. And these movies will do huge numbers at the box office, so, like, it's a good formula for making money. But I miss the originality of Disney animated features. So
I didn't ask for Moana 2 at this. We have too much Moana coming. I love Moana.
Yeah, aren't they doing a live-action one, too? I think they're doing a live-action Moana, too.
It's a live-action and Moana 2. And I will preface this by saying, Chris, we do, like, random conversations at the dinner table, and the other night's question was if you could have any Disney character as your sidekick for an adventure, who would it be? And I said Moana. I think she's awesome. I love her.
Moana's great.
I don't need all the extra Moana.
I'm with you.
Okay. Your next movie.
All right, my next one is Maxine. I'm stealing it. This is the third film in the X saga. If you've never seen these movies, the first movie was called X. These are horror movies directed by Ty West. First movie was X. The second movie was the prequel called Pearl. This is starring the great Mia Goth, one of my favorite actresses. Ty West also, by the way, his filmography, X, Pearl, Maxine, and the new Justin Timberlake music video. How about that?
Which one?
The No Angels.
What?
Yeah, so there you go. This is going to take place in the 80s, 1980s Hollywood adult film star and aspiring actress Maxine finally gets her big break, but as a mysterious killer stalks the starlets of Hollywood, a trail of blood threatens to reveal her sinister past.
I'm a star!
Dude, those are two of my favorite modern horror movies, X and Pearl. Mia Goth is great in both of them. This cast is huge. Michelle Monaghan, Giancarlo Esposito, Kevin Bacon, Elizabeth Debicki, Lily Collins, Halsey, Bobby Cannavale. Like, they got a huge cast for this movie. I think it's going to be the best horror movie of the year. I also think it has potential, just because of the cast and the hype around it, I think it has potential to maybe break into the Oscars threshold, which horror movies never do. So I'm looking forward to that.
I don't hate that hot take. I'm so excited for this, and I should have known better to leave it hanging on the board with you sitting beside me. But
yep.
I think Mia Goth is wildly talented.
Oh, I love her.
So good.
She should have been nominated for Pearl. She was amazing in that movie. Yep.
She should have.
Watch those movies.
All right, now I have to get strategic, because now I'm nervous about what else you're going to take.
I don't know if you'll have either of these last two.
Okay.
Maybe you will.
I will take Joker, Folie à Deux.
Yep.
The sequel to The Joker with Lady Gaga coming in as Harley Quinn, Joaquin Phoenix continuing his life as the Joker. It is a musical. Of course, I'm going to pick a musical, but I am genuinely very curious about this. They've kept so much of like the construction of the story, what it actually is, close to the vest. We do know at this point that there will be 15 songs used throughout. They have made it feel like it is going to be a jukebox musical, which I'm sure how I feel about. They're all covers. We only know one of them. It's Judy Garland's That's Entertainment, which I guarantee 99.9% of you don't know. But I absolutely performed That's Entertainment at Disneyland circa 2003.
Shout out.
So that's in. Yeah, we're going to stop right there. I am fascinated by this. And Lady Gaga has been very, very particular on what acting projects she has worked on. She's like gone all in a yep. very committed way since doing A Star Is Born. She did the House of Gucci, which some people made fun of, but I actually loved.
I never saw
the costumes were fantastic within it. And again, shout out Adam Driver for everything. But I can't wait to see this movie just because I can't wait for the mystery to be solved of what it's going to be.
I agree with that. The first Joker was really good. And this one sounds like an interesting concept. And dude, Lady Gaga in a Joker movie singing mm-hmm. songs, like, I'm good. Give it to me. Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah. She's just like a forever theater kid.
Yeah, so. Yeah. That'll be fun. And her and Joaquin Phoenix, that'll be fun too. I'm interested to see how it all comes together. I think it'll surprise people. I'm with you.
Yeah.
My next pick is the new Alien movie, Alien Ooh. Romulus. I love my weak spot or the Alien.
One of my favorite Predator movies of all time universe. Is Alien.
Yeah. Mine's Aliens, the James Cameron one, but okay. but I love Alien okay. as well. Also loved the Ridley Scott like prequels, Prometheus, Alien Covenant. I love this universe. This one
I
is
love this universe.
This I love the Alien universe. I'm a weirdo. All of my movies are like post-apocalyptic or like uh-huh. weird horror. Yeah, besides Deadpool and Wolverine.
Welcome to Bennett's Brain.
Yeah, this is directed by Fede Alvarez, who did the newer Evil Dead movie and Don't Breathe. So he's a horror movie director, which is cool because like the most popular movie in this entire saga is Alien, the first one, I think. I mean, Aliens, the sequel is really great, too. It's my favorite. But it is a straight-up horror movie, Alien is. And the fact that they got a horror director who's done some good movies to come on board and do this new installment in the Alien universe, I think it's got a potential to be really good. I think the trailer looks pretty scary, so I'm excited about Alien Romulus.
Did you ever do the Great Movie Ride at Hollywood
yes,
Studios
that's
back in the day?
That's another reason why it is one of my favorites, is because that scene, I mean, it used to terrify me as a kid. I literally think that's why they got rid of that ride at Disney World,
scary.
Because it was way too scary
I went on
for
Tower of
kids.
Terror before I went on the Great Movie Ride
yeah.
because I was so scared of the alien popping out.
Yeah.
And I had watched, because I was such a little nerd, there were the VHS tapes of like all the different theme parks
yep.
and you could go through all the different rides, and so I knew it was there and I was far too scared to do the Great Movie Ride. But shout out Sigourney Weaver, one of the greatest performances in a horror movie of all time, because it is indeed a horror
yes,
movie.
Yes, it is.
Okay, I am going to take this next pick and hope and pray that you don't steal my
okay.
final pick afterwards. But I first am going to take The Fall Guy, which comes out May 3rd, starring Ryan Gosling
yeah.
and Emily Blunt. And it is about a stuntman who is retired who comes back to go on a search for a missing actor. This would normally not be my kind of movie, but the early reviews for this movie were phenomenal in a sense that it's not just stunts to stunt.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's a very physical comedy.
Yep.
And we don't do those all the time very well anymore, but people have said that this is a very, like, pure funny. There's a love story.
Yep.
It's charming. It has like rom-com vibes, but in a not too cheesy kind of way. And they've broken a ton of Guinness records for the various stunts that they've tried, so like the stunts will be awesome. But give me The Fall Guy and Ryan Gosling, so hot right now.
Yeah, when I saw the trailer in theaters a couple weeks back, I was like, why? This looks terrible. Like, why are
yes.
they doing this? Why would Emily Blunt and Ryan Gosling do a movie like this? I think the trailer did not do it justice at
no.
all, because literally everything I've read or seen about this movie says, It's awesome. It's like a big blockbuster, but it also pays homage to Hollywood and to stunt workers.
It's based on a TV show.
Yeah, okay. And so, yeah, I'm excited about it, too. I wasn't, like I said, when I saw the trailer, but everybody seems to suggest it's really good.
And now I'll be disappointed if it's as bad as I thought it was originally going to be based on the first trailer.
That's true. Okay, my last one is a movie that's coming out in a couple weeks this summer. It is Furiosa, Mad Max saga. This is the origin story of Furiosa, who made her debut in Mad Max Fury Road, which was one of the greatest movies ever, in my opinion. I think it should have won Best Picture that year. It won a bunch of technical awards and stuff. Directed by George Miller. This is starring Anna Taylor-Joy. She plays Furiosa. Chris Hemsworth's in it. I love the Mad Max movies, all of them. Even, I know Mel Gibson, I get it, but he's amazing in those movies. Like the first three Mad Max movies are so good. The Road Warrior is one of my favorite movies ever. Mad Max Fury Road, the latest one that came, well, I guess it came out in like 2014 or something. Yeah. It's been a long time.
2015.
Yeah, 2015. And that was starring, why am I blanking? Who's my guy? Tom Hardy. Yeah.
And Charlize Theron.
So he replaced Mel Gibson as Mad Max. And Charlize Theron played an older Furiosa. This is about her origin story, like I said. And I just love these movies. I was so excited when I found out that he was making this. And I've noticed, like I said, that all of my picks are either like horror or post-apocalyptic weirdness. So that says something about me. But I think this has potential to be great. Just because Mad Max Fury Road changed the game as far as what you could do in movies. And I think George Miller's a genius. So I'm really excited about this one.
The year that it lost Best Picture, Spotlight won. It was a big year for movies.
That's crazy, though.
Big Short,
in retrospect,
Brooklyn,
that makes no
Martian,
sense.
The Martian, The Revenant, Room, and I agree. I was pulling for Mad Max. Very
yeah.
Here. All right, my final pick. I'm so grateful you didn't take it, but I didn't think that I had any concern waiting until the very end. Next Christmas, I will be celebrating with Wicked Part 1, and I am...
I was leaving it for you.
So mad that they turned this into two movies, but I will get over it quickly when I hear the sweet, sweet sounds of Cynthia Erivo, who is a queen, which is how I ended up on YouTube watching the Carole King Kennedy Center honorees, not because Cynthia Erivo was on it that year, but she was on the Kennedy Center honorees this past year where she's seeing Alfie with Dionne Warwick. If you have never seen the Cynthia Erivo cover of I Want to Dance with Somebody, Whitney Houston song, she does a jazz version of it, and it's, you can find it anywhere, and it's so beautiful. Ariana Grande's marriage broke up for this movie. Not officially, but we're going to say it that way because the guy that she had the affair with, even though her husband might have been having an affair too, is in Wicked, the movie. The first trailer came out during the Super Bowl, and it looked, it sang budget to me. Like they had money and they used it. Mm-hmm. And I was a little nervous because in order to do a movie musical well, you have to put all of the money into that movie musical. I am very much staunchly like musicals are always 10 out of 10 better on stage. There are very, very rare occasions where I like movie musicals better or equally to the stage production, but Wicked has so much energy behind it. I am so hopeful. And I see Wicked here in Memphis next.
That's right. It's here
Wednesday.
Next week, right?
So 3 weeks in a row.
For
it's here
3 weeks,
right now.
Yeah.
You too can go see Wicked.
I think we're going to go check it out. Yeah, I think we're going to go check it out. Yeah, I got to take the kiddos to see that one.
I'm very excited.
Yeah, I've seen it before. It's a good show.
Okay, what are your honorable mentions before we let you out?
Oh, my honorable mentions. Okay, a lot of one that I wanted to get on here, but I just couldn't fit it in. Beetlejuice.
Yes.
Yeah. Love the original. I'm glad that they're bringing back Michael Keaton. Jenna Ortega's in it. So the trailers look good. Tim Burton back to using practical effects, it appears. So that's a good thing. I'm excited about, we mentioned the Disney movies, Moana 2, Inside Out 2. I'm excited about both of those. Kingdom of the Planet of the Apes. I loved those movies. Excited they're doing another installment. A Quiet Place Day 1.
Yep.
I'm excited about.
That's on mine.
Twisters.
That's on mine.
Twisters. My mom's favorite movie, Twister. So excited about the sequel to that, I guess. Nosferatu coming out, the new David Eggers movie. And another one that I couldn't leave off was Terrifier 3, which is...
Oh.
Which is, if you've never seen the Terrifier movies, just be careful. It ain't for the faint of heart.
I'm very excited for Nosferatu. And I think you said Twisters. The only one you didn't say that was on my honorable mentions is Challengers, which is
the Zendaya movie.
Threesome with her little white boys. And it's a tennis movie. And I did see this very interesting graphic that was circulating yesterday. We talked about Kirsten Dunst earlier. But there has been a Spider-Man to tennis pipeline. And I think it needs to be discussed because obviously Zendaya has been in the most recent Spider-Man movie. Mm-hmm. She's now making Challengers, which is a tennis movie. You had Emma Stone. Who did Battle of the Sexes following her role with Spider-Man. And you had Kirsten Dunst, who did Wimbledon after she was in Spider-Man. So I don't know what's going on here.
Mind blown.
But Spider-Man, Spider-Verse to tennis-verse is a thing.
Dude, you got to put this out here. I have not seen anybody mention.
Somebody else put it out. Yes, I saw it came on my timeline yesterday. Okay. Shout out to Mari on Twitter, but I was like,
that's wild.
Oh, so there. So I really hope Challengers is good. I'm a little nervous. It feels a little weird. Feels a little wacky. We'll see. But it is a very Zendaya year after Dune, so a lot of energy there. And then I also have two honorable mentions of movies I am most excited to hate watch, which means I will not go see them in theaters. I will wait for them to be free on my television. But Back to Black, the Amy Winehouse biopic.
For sure. Yeah.
The first trailer came out, or the first clip came out. It looks so bad.
Does it?
Like, why was this made? How was this made?
I think we need to take a back seat on the music biopics. Bob Marley one flopped. They're trying to redo Bohemian Rhapsody because it won Best Picture. Best Picture? Yeah, it won Best Picture.
Yes.
Yeah.
No.
Or Best Actor.
Best Actor for Malick.
Yeah. And I just think that they're trying to capitalize off that. And there just really hasn't been anything as good since. So, yeah, I don't know.
There was a lot of controversy over the casting of Amy Winehouse in this movie. And I wasn't familiar with the girl. She was on the show Industry. Her name's Marissa Abella.
Okay.
But it's not a fit. Although I did see, I was surprised to see Leslie Manville, who just played older Princess Margaret on The Crown, who I love. Yeah. She's in it.
Yeah.
But nothing can make me excited about it. So I'll hate watch that. And then I'll also be hating Horizon and American Saga, the new Kevin Costner movie that I knew nothing about until we were at Dune 2 and the preview was during it. And we were like, what in the hell is this whitewashed American history film before us? And it was Horizon and American Saga. And I'm just like sheer curiosity, like sick curiosity
of how it
was made, because a certain news network is really excited about it.
Okay, got it. Yeah,
I'm we'll go from there. Bennett, it was so fun. Thanks for coming and drafting movies and talking about Grizzlies future championships and all that jazz. I know you are hosting the Gary Parra Show. Gary will along the way, but it'll be Bennett, it'll be John Roser. They will carry you through the rest of your Thursday coming up at 10 on Grind City Media. If you're watching live, go ahead, smash that like button, subscribe to GCM on YouTube. You know the drill. And tomorrow will be Friday. We'll be able to preview the Final Four. CJ will be back, I think. We'll get into the weekend. It'll be good. The sun is out. Blue skies. Get outside a bit. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye.
Another one that I left off my list
was,
where is it? Gladiator 2.
I didn't need another Gladiator.
That's why it was deep.
Do we need
another Gladiator?
No.
All these years later?
I loved Gladiator. Do I need it now? No.
No, I didn't either.